Well, welcome to the first evening of Catalyst Lectures. It looks like things are off to an amazing start out there. Lots of incredibly interesting things going on. I want to first thank Luke Bowman for a fantastic lecture this afternoon. That was really incredible. I know a lot of people enjoyed it. Yeah, let's come on. Thank you. And then I'll introduce our keynote address speaker tonight, Michael Young. I'll start with the standard, and at my peril, I'll drift a bit. Michael is an architect and an educator practicing in New York City, where he's the founding partner of the architecture and urban practice design firm Young and Iotta. Young and Iotta formed a partnership in New York in 2008 to explore the conceptual and aesthetic possibilities of architecture and urbanism. The practice is dedicated to both built commissions and experimental research, and views the reality of contemporary building as a provocation for architectural form, material, and technology. Both principles teach and view the educational experience as crucial to the continual development of architectural ideas. As such, Michael is an assistant professor at the Cooper Union in New York City. He's a visiting assistant professor at Princeton University, where he teaches courses in geometry and representation. Michael's also taught at Yale, Columbia, and Syracuse, and Innsbruck, to just name a few. Young and Iotta is one of two first prize winners, this is a huge award, in the international competition for the new Bauhaus Museum in Dessau, Germany. I hope we'll be seeing some of that tonight, yeah. Recently, they were finalists in the 2015 MoMA Young Architects Program in Istanbul. In 2014, they were awarded the Young Architect Prize from the Architecture League of New York. In 2015, the firm's work was also exhibited at the Museum of Modern Art in New York, as well as Istanbul Modern and Princeton University. I wanted to take just a minute to introduce Michael beyond his CV and why, in particular, he was my guest and for this important week and why I invited him as keynote. The themes for this year's Catalyst is representing systems, as you all know. And for me, Michael's output tackles this topic head on with no exceptions. For him, representation is not a way to depict a preconceived design, but is an act of creation unto itself. I came to know Michael through his writings, particularly concerning the evolution of spline geometry and its remediation through an ever-changing mathematical, industrial, and technological context. Students of mine know well that I often refer them to Michael's texts, particularly for their clarity of concept and ability to resituate our current conditions within a historic trajectory. These writings indicate something. As well as an architect, Michael is a relentless scholar of history whose work is no doubt informed by a nuanced understanding of our places within historic realities. One of my favorite writings of Michael's is a quick and candid romp through the last 400 or so years of architectural representation, to which he squarely calls to task the victors of a northern Italian painterly squabble over the superiority of form versus color. Who wins out, naturally, but form? Materiality takes a backseat for the next few centuries, and consequently, today we have a discipline that's heavily reliant on formal geometric mediations. In his own work, Michael's approach is much more subtle and synthetic, perhaps purposefully unbiased to these representational squabbles, while at the same time acutely noting their historic repercussions and impacts shaping our current realities. In response, be they through hybrid drawing paintings, objects, or buildings themselves, Michael offers up mashups. These works are anything but formal play for their own sake. Such a reduction would be an error of the casual and lazy observer. Instead, what is offered is a mashup remediated by the very systems of representation on which we rely in our daily architectural practices. It is these very systems of representation that Michael finds traction, ultimately producing something that is not quite surface and not quite rendering, amounting to a synthesis of materiality and form, with one not favored over the other, but in careful and mutual tension. In Michael's words, these are the relations between objects themselves. Aesthetic relations of color, texture, materiality, luminosity, and reflectivity. The works of Young and Iotta are not formal objects created for their own sake, but carefully situated convergences. They are created from the stuff of material representation, color, texture, luminosity, and reflectivity, rendered at a given fidelity and as reflections of our own collective memories. These are carefully calibrated reflections, not reduced to pure symbols that can be read linguistically for their meaning. They're themselves remediators, pushing back while defamiliarizing us, the observers, through an aesthetic experience that pressures our realities through their very being. With that, let's welcome Michael.
Thanks, man. That was really nice. All right. So first off, thank you, Andrew. Thanks for bringing me here, and thanks to the faculty in the School of Architecture. This is my first time in Minnesota, so obviously my first time in Minneapolis. But it's, I actually have to say, this is a city I've been thinking about fairly consistently for 30 years, and you'll see why in just a minute. So this quote that's up here that you've been looking at, don't start with the good old things, but the bad new ones. So it's become a cliche, but something that we hear again and again, that everything's in crisis. Architectural representation's in crisis with its advent of digital technology. Our world's in an ecological crisis. Our world's in a social cultural crisis. Our world's in a crisis with its economy and capitalism. And all of these things may be true. We hear them often enough, and they do have real aspects that we see in our day-to-day life. And we have maybe a few roads that we can travel when we try to deal with this. One is we can try to reject, resist it, remove ourselves from it, and go back to a previous time, try to find out when things were better, and from that point then readjust and move forward. Or we can say it's business as usual, it doesn't have anything to do with me, this is just the way in which the world works and the way in which the world goes, and I'm gonna go along with it and see what happens next. Or we can dive into it in another way. And the implication here with the Brecht quote is that the only way forward is through. That instead of trying to resist it, that there's a possibility that we could engage in it and accelerate it. So yeah, I've been listening to Husker Du and The Replacements solid for 30 years. These people have been my Minneapolis sound, and it's incredibly, I'm just happy to be here and be in the town that they came from. But also, for me, okay, so this is 30 years ago, but that sound of that song in that album with these images coming to a kid in Orange County, California, looking at these things and saying, what the hell is this? I hadn't heard anything that sounded like that. The drums sounded like they were machines. The guitars didn't sound like guitars. They were fuzzed out to the point where you couldn't hear anybody strumming them. And then there's this guy that keeps coming on and keeps telling you about this new day rising. And he's not exactly happy about this new day rising. It's not exactly the pleasantries of looking forward to a new day. In fact, there's a little bit of a blunt cynicism or an attitude to it. So this, to me, is actually a version of an aesthetic acceleration. And it's not a smooth, happy acceleration. It's a rough acceleration. And I'm going to try to differentiate and distinguish these things as I present the lecture, because for me, it's not a effortless, smooth merger into the world of new technologies, into the flow of capital. It's something that actually needs to be roughed up. But it's also not a condition in which we can turn our backs to and believe that we can go elsewhere. We do live in a world that can be described as rapidly accelerating abstractions. And in that, we need to think a little bit about what the aesthetics of those abstractions are and how we as architects engage in them. So, first thing I want to put out here, and the first thing I want to ask ourselves is, what do we actually mean when we say abstraction? And there's many different possible interpretations to this. And I'll just throw up a couple strawman generalizations, examples of things we mean often when we talk about abstraction. Now, this is one from the sciences, one about electromagnetic activity. And we know the story. Michael Faraday puts some iron filings on a piece of paper with magnets underneath, and all of a sudden the filings splay themselves into these patterns. He captures them by actually embedding them in wax, indexically capturing that material movement, so he can then make a series of drawings, an abstraction of the abstraction, where now the hyperrealization is that the wax becomes real and the drawings become the abstraction, because the drawings now can be distributed, and it can earn him a new fan in the mathematician James Clerk Maxwell. So he takes those drawings and he begins to graph them out, abstractions of the drawings now into the lineage of line and the ways in which they denotate geometry. And from there begin to build up the next level of abstraction, which is the equations. Now we think about this, I don't know if I should hold this the entire time, it's like holding a really puny microphone. It's kind of funny. The word puny is kind of funny, by the way. Anyways, let's see if it works if I put it here. Is that okay? Can you still hear me if I just talk like this? Okay, fair enough, good. Now, where do we trust or where do we treat this abstraction? There's a little bit of the implication within mathematics and the sciences that once we've moved to the language of mathematics, we've moved through abstraction to a closer, more general reality, something that can be communicated anywhere, to many cultures, to many different specific situations, and is no longer tied to a single contingent materiality, but begins to describe something truer, we could say. Now, is that the same as when we look at one of our fictions, in a way, that talk about abstraction in modern art? And this is a lineage that owes everything to people like Clement Greenberg and ideas of medium specificity, but that basically starting somewhere there in the middle of the 19th century with people like Manet, we step forward and the paintings become flatter, the pigment becomes more exposed, the framing devices become more clearly articulated, till the time we finally get to somebody like Mondrian, where it is no longer representational of any visual resemblance into the world, but is just the abstract composition on the plane of the object itself. And then the weird thing, if you're no longer looking through something, but you're looking at something. And the step from that that Stella takes, where the composition is now fused with the framing element itself, and so you don't know what is frame and what is composition inside. In fact, they both reflectively work off each other, and now that becomes an object that Donald Judd pops off the wall, making it now an idea that can be coordinated and communicated through language, which finally ends us up in something like conceptual art. That each of these somehow is a step, an abstraction of the thing beneath it, the thing before it, the thing that came previous, and moves us closer and closer to a world of ideas, a world of concepts, a world of language. Is that the same as the example from the sciences? Or even in, let's just take technology, and we'll take one technology that we care about, which is the technology of media. So if you have a fresco painted where the pigment is embedded into the walls of the building, you have a technology of mediation, a material technology of mediation, which is proposing a scene or an image that is not there. But it's not very movable. You can't just move the chapel. But you can move a framed easel painting, and this is not a bad frame if you want to have a frame. And that then becomes a portable device, a device that can be moved from place to place to place. But there's still only one of them. But if you transform it through engraving and etching, you can then reprint it again and again through the printing press, and you can translate that through space and time, record it into books. We had a great lecture this morning about books and the ways in which images began to proliferate through the speed of the printing press, but translated through a technology of etching and engraving. Each time something shifted, each time it's faster, each time it's more mobile, each time the image becomes immutable, but then there's also with each of the changes of technology, a transformation of what it is that we're actually looking at and talking about. And then this gets even more rapid with something like photography, where the indexical trace of light captured on film through a lens begins to show us worlds we didn't know were there. I think we got substantially creeped out when we realized that
those were the things that were in our beds, right? We didn't know that before, but microscopic photography all of a sudden told us we were inhabiting a world with things much smaller and much larger than we could possibly understand, and that recording through the photograph, which could be printed again and again, gave us access to that kind of visual knowledge. Or the zoetrope as an entertainment device, which began to create the illusions of animation by putting frames again and again in transformation. Or linking up photography with the ideas of the zoetrope and Etienne Jules Marais in Muybridge for early cinema. Of course, early cinema can then be tied into photography and then projection to become the cinema of movies, which it once then gathered the things of the phonograph could become the sound cinema, and an entire new world was moving in front of us in terms of the technologies of these mediations. Again, an abstraction through the deskotization. We don't really remember this all that much, but film is a deskotization of 24 frames per second. Things must be cut, stopped, and then played again in order for us to have that persistence of vision that moves the image. Television, then. Television, a way in which signals could be carried, split, moved through the air with radio, reassembled, and now viewed in your home. So it was no longer the situation of going to the place of assembling for viewing the images, but the images had pervaded your house. And it's also a good thing to remember that cable, which is not that old, here's 1973 ad for cable TV. What cable TV does in many ways is not just give you more channels, 10 channels instead of 3, but it also begins to change our relationship to time. The television used to go off. The broadcast used to stop. With cable television, things started to go 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, which is the world we live in now, a world where data is translated through our cables to meet us on our computer screens, however they may be viewed mobilely or through the traditions of a television set. And 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, we have a discretized view of the world. Now, Thomas Ruff may find an aesthetic in that and does so in a very compelling way with his JPEG series. But is this the same kind of hyper-realization of abstractions that are ever increasing as we saw within modern art or within the sciences? And probably the most abstract thing we have cooking today is our economy or our currency. So that coin may gain reality or may gain its value through the image of the Caesar, the image of ruler that's been imprinted on it, and then the material worth of itself, the silver that it's imprinted in, so that the currency had this material thing that it was referencing. We know that our banknotes were actually things initially that were traded in for that silver. And up until 1971, if you look at this dollar bill here, which is from the late 60s, you can see that it says a silver payable for this paper on demand. That paper was a representation. It's no longer the ruler, it's no longer the Caesar, but it is the president. And it's no longer the materiality, but it is the technology of engraving that has etched a pattern that would be hard to copy, so that ability to not copy it through the engraving of the patterns on it made it have value. But also it was something exchangeable. It was not the fiat that it is now. Our money is not exchangeable for any material good, yet it's a currency that we trade and we use to buy the goods of our lives. It's becoming more and more abstract. The credit card, maybe now there's a chip in it, and that data that is communicating your life into that sale is one advancement or acceleration of these things that have happened before. But really, if you think about what the credit card has changed, it's time. It's a temporal displacement of the way in which you pay. Because now you do not have to pay now, you can pay later. And in fact, that later can be endlessly deferred until you default, and then you have real problems. And all of the things we may be concerned about with artificial intelligence and the ways that those could impact our world, we've given our economy over to artificial intelligence, and we've done it in not many people are batting an eye. High frequency trading happens at a rate in which no person can possibly understand or control, and it is one of the major pieces that is running and flowing through our economy these days. So is that abstraction, the abstraction of capital, as it removes itself from material connections, as its representations remove themselves from representational signification, the same level of abstraction, the same kind of abstraction as the ones we've seen before? And I think probably by now you're going to realize I'm going to say no. Big reveal on that. What I'm going to suggest is that there's three ways we can think through this ever-escalating abstraction. Three modes in which we can understand these relationships that are being put forward in abstraction. One is ethics, ethical. One is epistemological. One is aesthetics. And I'd like to suggest that these three things are not causally related. There are three separate ways in which we relate to the world and should be treated as three separate ways that we relate to the world. All of them have their importance. All of them have their ways of operating, but they are not the same, nor is any one of them more important than the other. Ethics, again, has to do with questions of truth, questions of how we then value those truths to set up a system of morals that propose a way in which we could act in the world and to propose a way in which we should structure the actions of others as a society. Epistemology, how do we gain knowledge? How do we use knowledge? How do we understand through knowledge the world? And what are the access that we can get through that, and how can we teach it, and what are the ways in which we can trust it? And aesthetics, all of the kind of sensory relationships to qualities that we have from our sense organs to the world, but actually you could just say, what are the qualitative relationships of appearances and sensations that objects have between each other in the world? So abstraction can be understood as an ethic, abstraction as epistemology, abstraction as aesthetics. And these are different kinds of relations. So let's pull these out. The first thing I want to say is that this is intimately tied to the ideas of Jacques Rancière, French philosopher still alive and writing today. I'm not going to go through this at great length. It's not the place for it. But I do want to put it up there, and I do want to say a couple things about his idea of regimes of the distribution of sensible information. Poetic regime, or ethical regime, poetic regime, and aesthetic regime. And it's tied to those three that I just put down before: ethics, epistemology, and aesthetics. For Rancière, an ethical regime can be attributed to somebody like Plato. You remember from reading The Republic, Plato doesn't have a very good impression of people like painters. Painters produce illusions. That is not the truth. Do not be fooled by the illusion. That is just something that is there before your senses. The truth lies elsewhere. It's an ethic that finds, through abstraction to an ideal realm, there to be a truth, a distrust of the illusion of the senses, distrust of the illusion of art. The only good art is made by the people who practice trades, the people who practice crafts, the people who are working within a material, a tradition, in a function that is verified by that craft. And if you think this is something that has gone away, think about your own training. I think about my own training. There was a definite point in my life where I was taught if you were true to the program, true to the site, true to the material, true to the construction, your building would just be good. It would just look good. And aesthetics would be the automatic outfall of those kinds of truths. I hope we all realize by now that as important as all those things are, they don't automatically equate to an aesthetically provocative building, or they don't automatically equate to something that you would be interested in aesthetically. The poetic regime has its start with Aristotle, which says, you know what, that's not a problem. You know, we know art is not reality. We know that it's a fiction. We know that it constructs a world. We don't need to worry about it having ethical truth. What we need to worry about are the conventions that structure the way in which we interpret it and the way in which we teach it. Thus, epistemology. We need to know the rhetoric of how art operates. So this becomes a system through the Renaissance into the academies of conventions, of genres, of ways of interpreting art, of ways of constructing art, of ways of teaching art, and thus of ways of producing within that cluster of conventions for society. The aesthetic regime, Rancière posits, is something different. It's actually something that attempts to bash those genres, something that is asking a question more about the tension between reality and its representation, or about the estrangement of reality through representation. It's not built upon you having knowledge of the right conventions and codes. It's not built upon you having an ethical or moral relationship to what you're looking at. It's built upon something that makes you realize that the real that you've been seeing and habitually consuming is not what you thought it was, that it's a construct, that it can be other, that you can, through aesthetics, begin to build a politics, which is ultimately Rancière's suggestion, that aesthetics builds up political communities. So, Just a few images to kind of tease this out before we go on. This is Plato's famous allegory of the cave, where we are trapped there looking at shadows of projections on a wall, and we believe these shadows to be true. We believe these shadows to be real, and ultimately they're just puppets that are being marched in front of a fire, and the person who breaks free of those chains that sees the puppets and then sees that outside the cave there is something else and goes out that cave and sees the sunlight and is blinded. And this is Plato's allegory of where truth lies. The truth doesn't lie in what we see with our senses, but truth lies elsewhere. And it's an ethics that one could base the establishment of a republic, a society, a utopia on. You know what happens, though, to the philosopher who breaks those chains and comes back in and tells everybody, hey, what you're looking at is just a shadow. Yeah, everybody basically assaults him and says he's a crazy guy. What the hell are you looking at? We're looking at reality. You think you're looking at reality. No one agrees with you. Why don't you put your chains back on? Let's get on with it. And this is one of the problems of that seduction through images, which is still alive today. Poetic regime. This is an academic painting, a beautiful painting. I don't mean to disparage it as well, but there is content here, content from Ovid's Metamorphosis that you should know. And the painting is structured to convey that content through its organization. It has an axis of symmetry. Here, I get the pointer out, right? You guys have all done this at some point in your life, I'm sure. An axis of symmetry that cuts right down, a horizontal symmetry cuts right over, there's Venus. That's the focus, there's the head. If you didn't know that, here's an arch with this shawl that's even encircling her head even further. If you didn't know that, there's a pyramid. And this pyramid structures a hierarchy of relationships that focuses our attention on that moment. And if that wasn't enough, follow the gaze. Where are we looking? Where are we looking? Where are we looking? Where are we looking? All those gazes redirect and structure your interpretation of the narrative of the birth of Venus, from the land of the gods to the world of man, from the sea to the land, from the heavens to the earth. Each of these hierarchies become axes that allow you to interpret that painting. It's based on knowledge of those codes and conventions of proportion and geometry. It's based on knowledge of the poetic content of classical culture. This being from the aesthetic regime, this being French realism, Gustave Courbet's painting of the burial at Ornon, offers a very different kind of experience. First of all, this is a gigantic painting of a very normal, everyday kind of thing. You gotta realize that you have to release content from its meaning before you can paint something abstractly. But also, there's a whole number of abstractions in this painting. This is not a normal realism, if this is the reality of what one would paint as well. Few things. This is not a kind of perspectival space in which you can recede to. In fact, the whole thing is blocked off. It's much closer to a bas-relief, where the people look like they're about to fall into your face. Secondly, this has organization, but it is not classical composition. It's more like thing after thing after thing after thing after thing. It's more like the ways in which the chairs are arranged. But those chairs are arranged here in one pattern. The people are arranged in another, a kind of accordion-like sinusoidal movement that goes in a large sweep and then in small sweeps. So there's a composition here, but it's a composition that's particularly attacking the classical composition. Then there's all these twinnings. So these gentlemen as twins, these gentlemen as twins, the handkerchief as twins, the two girls twinning vertically here, the choir boys, the pallbearers, and then this conjoined-headed twin of what appears to me always as a single figure in red, kind of swiping out its space in the middle. And then if we think about the conventions of the gaze, no one here in this painting is looking at each other. The only way I've ever seen this is on a New York City subway, but no one here is looking at anybody else, except for this cat here holding the cross. And he's looking out at you. And at that moment there, you're implicated. So this is a realism. And it's a realism that's putting attention on reality and its representation. And it's doing so through abstraction. Each of those things are an abstraction, a decontextualization, a flattening out of the space of the painting, an exposure of the pigment of the material, an abstraction of using concepts like twinning or distracted or deflected gaze of absorption. Each of those things are abstractions which are distancing a naturalism of realism and beginning to provoke an estrangement of the real which is what realism actually does. So let's step into contemporary art. We got to bring it a little bit closer to today. So Gerhard Richter, maybe one of the most famous living painters, but often a conundrum for people, because Gerhard Richter paints paintings like this, and he also paints paintings like that. And a simplistic way to say this would be that he has realism and he has abstraction. But Richter himself has never seen a harsh divide between these things. He's never seen them as radically different. And in fact, what Richter is involved with is a kind of realism which puts a tension on the medium. And here the medium is painting, coming into conflict with photography, and he's painting the smudge that we begin to appear as a blur. Paint doesn't blur. It just doesn't. It smudges, but it doesn't blur. Lenses blur, photos blur. That's an affect that comes with the trails of the technology of photography. But paint doesn't blur. If you want paint to blur, you actually have to screw with it intensely in an abstract manner in order to get it to blur out. And to do that both at the level of its relationships to photographic blur and at its relationships to the smearing of the paint itself are equal kinds of experiments. If you look at a painting such as his copy of the Annunciation after Titian, you realize that this is not one painting, this is five paintings. He had to do it five times, and each one has a different question about what it would be to take pigment, push pigment through abstraction and figuration to the moments in which it gained its own kind of reality, and yet still held itself in tension through the smudging, which became an optical blur. Even more recently, there's a series of paintings that he did this to. So he took that painting and mirrored it in Photoshop and then said, those look like tapestries. Let's put them up on the wall. So now all of a sudden, one of these problems that has been lurking there within abstraction throughout the 20th century is its proximity to decoration, its proximity to graphic design. And he's making a full-blooded claim for that, that there is a relationship between the abstractions that one may want to read expressivity to, but actually their ties to mechanisms. And this gets even more provocative in a book he puts out called Patterns, where he takes that same painting and mirrors it again and again and again and again and again. And I was thinking about this, Luke. The book makes only sense as a double fold-out against itself. It's really, I'm doing it a disservice here by cropping these images. But this operation that takes a painting and moves it through points where it's like almost like Christmas wrapping paper, right? But then color fields to the point where at the end, we're dealing with color bands. And I don't know if she's turning around with a look of being nonplussed or with a look of, hey, you got to come up here and see this because you're going to get your head blown off. But there's a weird thing going on here, which is through the mechanical reproduction of slicing, collaging, and mirroring, you begin to blur your own painting as an abstraction of an abstraction. You can see the bands of color. It's just a slice that ends up getting mirrored, and through that mirroring, it begins to become something else. It begins to become what we would call an abstract color band or color field painting. Another person here, putting this tension, this estrangement between abstraction and realism in play. This is Taube Auerbach. Now, she does these paintings in a really interesting manner, because she actually does literally fold up the fabric. And then she paints them with this kind of dichronic paint that has reflectivities of different angles. And then she stretches them flat. So they are flat, flat, flat. As flat as you can get. So this is like an illusionistic realism, right? But they're hovering there because the dimensions that they're giving you, the spatial dimensions that they're giving you, actually are the index of a material process done to the literal material of the canvas itself. Only what you're seeing as depth is not literally the depth that is there. So this tension between abstraction and realism. The most recent exhibit, and I put this in just because I saw this a couple weeks ago, is that she has made these instruments, which are kind of incredible 3D printed objects in their own right as geometric abstractions. But really, all these things are tools to do this. Tools to scrape, to pattern, to present an abstraction of the canvas, not that dissimilar actually to the scrapes and smears of Gerhard Richter, but their tracing is not the tracing of the ways in which one would put order into it as a conscious composition, but the traces of material tools residued onto the material of the canvas. Literal indexes. The last artist I'm going to show you is a Dutch artist, Harmen Brinthauer. Harmen Brinthauer, for 30 years, has done two shapes, squares and cones. That's it. He's only done two shapes. Squares stand in for the history of painting. The cones stand in for the history of sculpture. But he does them in lots of different ways. And so what you could understand in Brinthauer's project is he's going to work his way through every single decorative craft and art movement that has been done by every culture throughout the history of humankind, and he's not going to change the form. So these range from these kind of incredibly detailed Art Deco silver filigree things to instruments that are bronze bells to 3D prints that are plastic woven, stacked wool. This one happens to be one of my favorites. They each come also with a scenario that's kind of an incredible aspect to each of them. This one is called Dragon's Dropping. And there's this very specific Chinese dragon that's a combination of eight animals, a camel and a lizard and a crane and this and that and this. And he collects the shit from those eight animals and then he makes that cone. So that literally is a dragon's dropping, as real as you can get at this period of time. But the project I want to talk about from him that I find fascinating in this tension between abstraction and realism, or the way in which abstraction can estrange the real, is this project where you walk into a room and you see hanging on the wall these things. Now, we're all architects. We might as well be walking into a material sample room with a bunch of marble hanging on the walls. And that's kind of what you think first, like, okay, great, those are nice pieces of marble. Why am I in an art gallery? What else is going on here? And you come close to them. They're all fake. They're all fake marble painting. What he did is he hired the best fake marble painters in the entire world, and he gave them a 1 meter by 1 meter square and said, I want you to improvise your favorite material texture. If you become an expert at painting marble, it's not like you sit there with a photograph of marble and then you sit there and do this across the room. No, you actually learn that material so well that you can improvise it, that you can run that system of representation throughout the entirety of a room. And throughout the entirety of that room, that marble becomes the background. And that background is supposed to be reality. But we know that that background's an illusion of a real material that's not there. But now in the gallery, these are no longer the background, they're the foreground. And they're sitting there as fragments of real painting, but fake marble. And then you realize that the title of the exhibit is False Abstracts, and actually they're fake abstracts. They're not actually abstract painting, they're people trying to paint things, and you're getting the same response you get to a Jackson Pollock. So if you're getting the same response to somebody who's trying to copy marble that you would get from abstract expressionism in its heightened forms that we find in people like Pollock, we're going to have to think differently about abstraction and realism and the ways in which we aesthetically understand the background of reality. So here's a project that we did. I'm going to feed into this lecture in various ways some of Young and Ayada's work. So I have a practice in Brooklyn. I have a partner, Kutan Ayada, and we do different things that range from drawings to objects to buildings. So this is an object project. And we printed, designed and printed these four different vases. And each of these objects was an experiment in the ways in which color, texture, and ornament could play off of surface form in a manner that would sometimes reiterate the form and other times move across the form. It's really trying to play out the difference between ornament and decoration. If ornament is a articulation that attracts your attention to a certain moment to try to give you some kind of content symbolically. It says, look here, I'm a column capital, look here, I'm the arched entryway. Decoration actually tries to blur into mood or affect that's in the background that presents the attitude of a space or a style, yet not the focused attention for some kind of symbolic content. So could you do something with form, ornament, and decoration? And that's where these three prints came from. Why we found them interesting as well is that they began to have material associations that were beyond the material they are made out of. So that the way in which I related to these textures was very different than the way in which I related to these. And yet, it's all just powder, just 3D printed powder, printed in color, articulated differently in the way in which its surface qualities are given. And you begin to get things that range from something that's providing almost like a kind of stone warmth to something that looks like it's been eroded by time, to something that looks like a sinew sac of a biological organism, to something that then looks like the rotted feathers of a dead bird. And so these are the kind of things that we're getting, at least us, maybe our own problems, from our work. Where this exercise took on its next life was we began to jack them into 17th century Dutch still life paintings. And the argument with this was that the Dutch still life paintings were an undervalued genre throughout its history until really the 19th century kind of recuperated them and really investigated them in a different manner, treating them as an expression of something alternate to the traditions we took from the Northern Italian Renaissance and as a legitimate mode of representation and aesthetics in their own right, coming from Belgium, the Lowlands, the Netherlands, and Flanders. And they were composed as collage compositions over time. An object was put in, another object was put in, the study between them was then investigated. What were the reflections between that glass and that pewter? What are the luminosities in the lemon that's captured by the light, and how would that then reflect off another object put into that scene? And so that this wasn't a painting that was trying to build a narrative, this was a painting that was trying to build a scene. Much more about the descriptive specifics of a scene as opposed to the interpretive narratives of poetics. And in that, we saw it much closer to a kind of realism than we found in other kinds of paintings. And for us, this was the most successful one, and success was measured as thus. We sent it to a bunch of our friends, and we asked them, what do you think? And what we got back was mostly, what did you do? One guy thought, oh, you turn a lobster upside down, it's really funny. Another guy thought we put an egg in the oyster. They were looking for something, and really the elephant in the image, the elephant in the room, is the thing that we put in there. Yet, could you get it to fit well enough that it would begin to disturb the attention to the context around it? So this is actually ultimately our argument about contextualism, is can you disturb something to the point that it fits in, yet it allows you to see the background, physical, ecological, cultural, that it's inserted in, that allows you to think differently about what that context is. Can you defamiliarize the habitually consumed context? Oh, I just went through images and I didn't want to. Now I do. All right. This is another exhibit that we just had up in Chicago. So these are flower vases. And these flower vases are actually five different flower vases all held together in one single base, which is why we're calling them base flowers. And there's a couple things we were up to with this. One, there is still our investigation of the ways in which ornament and articulation ties into form, but there was something else that we were trying to suss out, which is that there's nothing more artificial than killing a plant and then putting it on your mantle for aesthetic pleasure. And that's really what we do. A vase is a thing that delays its death. It has some water in it. It has to disappear, so you only see the flower. It cuts it out of whatever context it was in and abstracts it into the domestic interior. Yet we have no problem doing this. Every single architectural record has a architectural digest, has a very nice interior in it that has cut flowers. And these are things we give to our loved ones, we give them to our grandma, we give them to our mom, and yet there's something very weird about the artificiality of the ways in which we aestheticize nature. So could you do a vase that turned the flowers into characters, that turned them into an attitude, and posed them? which is what a vase does. It poses a flower. And so could it pose flowers in arrangements that allowed them to become curious, clever, funny, goofy, however you understand characterizations, and from that then begin to think a little bit differently about the aesthetics of the cut flower. So these are the vases. They can it's one vase, it just tumbles into different positions. Those are the five vases which are locked with inside that body, and they kind of build up to have these different character poses. Now there's also something else going on here, because you spend so much time looking at the vase because you think that's the thing that the person designed because it's in a gallery, and that person in the gallery probably designed a vase, but could you design flowers? And so we designed some flowers. And could you then jack the flowers into the real flowers? So you have real fake flowers and fake real flowers. And can you put those two things together to the moment when people walk by, they don't notice them at first, but they notice something's wrong. What is wrong? I'm not sure. And I stood in the gallery waiting for somebody to touch these. And finally somebody went up and touched them, and I said, all right, that person got it. Because these are things, these are fake flowers that have been jacked in. They're kind of mutant species that are built to not look like the flowers that they're modeled after, but to take principles, genetic principles maybe, within the form, texture, coloration, and then insert themselves into the context of the real flowers. And then there was these little guys that kind of sprawled around, and then there's some ones that like to pile up like dogs. So this is another aspect that we're trying to do with this abstraction, realism, estrangement. So that brings us to this experience we just had over the last 6 months that Andrew referenced. So we were one of two first place prize winners for a new museum for the Bauhaus in Dessau, Germany. There was 851 entries. I don't have any idea why we're one of the first two place winners. Honestly, when you see my project, you'll know why. But to tell you what has happened, because 2 months ago they awarded the job and we did not win. And it's a little bit like the Miss Universe, where Miss Universe got crowned wrongly and then they had to take the crown off and say, oh, sorry, put it over here. But, you know, in the end, we have to be happy about it. It was a great experience for us, and it put us into a number of different explorations, and we'll see what we can build from it. So, Museum for the Bauhaus in Dessau, Germany. Right off, we did not want to do that. That's what we knew. And this for a number of reasons. First off, this was what the Bauhaus would have done in 1926. This was the Bauhaus as accelerationist in that moment. They would not have done the same thing today. They would not have tried to preserve a certain image of their identity 100 years later. Just wouldn't be within the idea of the Bauhaus. Two, this is not a museum for the architecture of the Bauhaus. This is a museum for the workshops, the school, the arts of the Bauhaus. And the moment that you start to look at what they were actually doing, you realize how weird this place was. This was a wonderful place, and it did some incredible things that we tend to sometimes ignore in architecture because we're so focused on Gropius. And I don't want to take anything away from Gropius. I just want to say that actually, if you're doing a museum for the Bauhaus as an idea within a contemporary moment, you're not going to be basing it on one aspect only. You're not going to be basing it only on the architecture. You're going to be basing it on the idea of the explorations that they had within aesthetics, material, color, technology, and abstraction. Because those were the things they were cooking, all as a social collective, a way in which a new school, a new method of design could be founded, not on teaching the academy, not on teaching the conventions of the academy, but by restructuring a mode of education that looked at the changes in technology, the powers of color, the powers of material, and in many ways, the questions of craft. And so in looking at these people, we found some things that we'd pull from. One, a kind of playful humor. Two, a kind of ability to merge figure and ground or figure and system. And then the idea that the technique of manufacture or the technology that one would work through a design was prone to leave its mark on that design and what we interpreted as a glitch, both in the photograms of Moholy Nagy and in the textiles that Annie Albers and Gunther Stoltz would build from, the kind of textile glitch where material fabric began to rupture the registration of a single image. You can also see it in the Paul Klee. And this was the idea that we wanted to accelerate to the 21st century. So these were the two schemes, yeah? I don't know, right? Like, how? So you got 850 entries and you end up with these. So ours is the one on the bottom, and the one on the top by a very nice Spanish firm, they're the ones who won. So obviously our idea to not make it within the image of the Bauhaus was not the right idea, and we lost, but so be it. That'll be how it goes, and we'll build on this scheme in the future. The other thing I need to point out is this building is not right next to the Gropius building. Here's the Bauhaus School, the Gropius workshops. The site is down here in the center of Dessau in the city park. So a city park is actually a rather strange place to put a building. You can't just drop it down. It's a different kind of context. And it's removed from the other architecture of the Bauhaus, presents it as a point that could be a different kind of aesthetic identity. So what we did was we wanted to keep a couple things alive in this park. One, we had an access, a corner access, the site was a corner site, that we wanted to run straight from the middle of the park into the major intersection of the city here. Secondly, we wanted it to touch down on the park lightly and hover above it. So it only touches the park in these points. There's a kind of entry floor and service floor. The entire museum is then a single elevated floor that's a single concrete structure. And then there's these hats or vessels that collect upon it on top that form the gallery spaces. The other thing we're looking at is what are the ways in which you can have an individual module always maintain its identity, yet have it also, at another level, completely subsumed into a system as rational as a grid. So it's a straight grid, there's only circles and squares in its plan geometry, but in its figuration as an elevation, you would never read that grid. You would never read that straight system that goes across the entire project. Instead, you would read object to object to object to object, vessel to vessel to vessel to vessel, as a kind of collective huddle, almost like penguins or gnomes huddling together and collecting around this place. So here's the main entry axis that goes from the corner to the center of the park. You can start to see that you can walk underneath the building in any situation and pass into the park. Here's it situated now along that side. This is from the park itself. And then this is the courtyard that you go to that's within it. Because the other thing we're after was a way in which to catch this textile glitch, this glitch that was in the textiles or in the patternings and discretizations of Paul Klee's paintings, in the smears of the photograms of Moholy Nagy, and what are the ways in which we could turn that into the aesthetic expression of the vessels themselves, that they had to play with color, and so we took two different stances, that the color on the outside would be more muted, would be simpler, would have allusions to other materials than what it was made out of, but that the color inside the courtyard would start to go haywire, would start to glitch out, and each of these moments where it touched down would be a flower bed, a flower garden that would begin to relate to those colors above. It's a little bit like what Kenny Price does with Joseph Albers, if you know the sculptor Kenny Price. He looks at Joseph Albers' color studies and begins to pull fragments of them out, which he infuses into these sculptures. If you don't know them, find them. I don't have a slide here, but it's was an inspiration of how we could take actually Joseph Albers' color studies and then glitch them across the surface to begin to create a different kind of patterning or an aesthetic field. Just a few moments with the plan. This is the site where each of those legs touch down into a flower bed. You enter in down that main axis into this lobby, up that stair, and you come up. There's a kind of cafe. To this side is a temporary exhibition, and then the permanent exhibition is along this edge. And this was the other aspect that we were after, because when these vessels fused together, they created a different kind of plan aesthetic than you would have thought of from the outside. So a few things, elevation, the sections moving in, here's that stair that rises up, there's a mezzanine for the administration above. Here's that main gallery floor, and you can start to see that what happens is when the vessels fuse together, they form larger gallery spaces with these double, single, sometimes triple skylights above. These are the people who were going to make it. Well, a little too loud. We viewed this as somehow also within a kind of accelerated, what? Oh, what happened? Oh, there you go. Sorry. With an accelerated version of the way in which these things would be fabricated. So it's basically you send in an image, the image is discretized to the tile, then robots put the tiles where you want to be, they begin to create the field, and that field then begins to collect the image. It's a company out of Boston called Archaic, and interesting fabrication process. This is the structural system. It was an egg crate structure that kind of wrapped up, so the entire top was very light, the entire bottom was very heavy, heavy concrete base, but then these light vessels on top of them. This is the entry lobby that pulls you up from the park and wraps you up into these spaces. The cafe, the only moment where the exterior wraps into the interior and becomes the ceiling of the cafe. And then these are what the gallery spaces become. So from the outside, a single vessel, which is only one, there's only one, it's just rotated and repeated along the grid, as it fuses up, begins to create very different kinds of episodic spaces, which are the gallery spaces inside. And those balls on the outside become skylights. We found a whole bunch of weird things, by the way, like the, I have to show you what I'm talking about here. But all these kinds of protruding objects through the ends of the light nozzles. You know, this is one of those things. You start looking for things sometimes on the internet, and eventually you find yourself in a world where very quickly you go, oh no, you turn your computer off very fast. There's a whole aesthetic movement out there that are about things coming out of things, crowning for those of you who have children. And it is a wild and weird world. And somehow, we're now in that aesthetic lineage. And we just kind of liked the strange idea that the light diffuser would be coming out of the nozzle. Little do we know that things can become much stranger than you actually intend them at first. It's always good, though. Okay. So I have one last theme for you, which is the idea of the parafictional. And this is realism now in photography and film primarily. This is a Belgian photographer, Philippe Dujardin. And he does really, really simple digital models, but then collages onto them real photographs he takes of real buildings. So these are real photographs of real buildings, but that's not a real building. And the thing he's always testing is at what level can I propose a reality that you accept, and then you say, wait a second, I'm not sure about that, man. In that moment of doubt, this is how the parafiction operates, that moment of doubt begins to open up a space of criticality. That estrangement of the real begins to put a point for you to actually ask, what is it that I'm looking at? How is the realism a construct, and what are the modes in which I can act in it and on it and through it? Now, some are more exotic. You know, that the materials are right, that things are kind of right, but yeah, I don't think they're going to be able to do that cantilever. It looks like it's just extended itself a little bit too far. I don't know if I'm going to be able to circulate through that building. It's got a significant amount of problems in its relationship to where a core would run. Here it's interesting because what came first, right? I always think it's a good idea if you can put a thing into the world and you don't know if that thing was there before the other things that are around it, you've done something significant. So if you can put a rock into an image of two buildings and those buildings now look newer than the rock, or does the rock look newer than the buildings? If the rock is newer than the buildings, we've got some questions to ask ourselves. But it makes you think differently about the temporal and origination. And probably the best one is this one. I showed this today in my workshop. Because there's some problems, and yet they ain't jumping out at you right away, are they? For instance, if this is a city, where are the streets? Because this looks like a city that's just a world of roof, 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 roof. And that's not a very inhabitable city, but it would lead you to propose, well, maybe in a city without streets, I also have a city without windows, because there's no windows in this image either. So you didn't see it at first, but you got an image that you accepted as real without streets and out windows. And that's a pretty strange pressure on where we determine what is real and what is not. And then the weird thing that happens is he's also an architectural photographer, and so you click on another thing that pops up in Google Image and you get this, and you're like, oh my God, that's weird, I can't believe that, but that's actually a real building. So that one's actually real. And these are photographs of real buildings put into places that don't exist. And so the questions get blurry, especially in our age of mediated environments in the internet. The next person I'm going to show is Joan Fontcuberta, a Spanish artist who works within this realm of the parafictionally real. This is his photograph documentary piece on Joan Fontcuberta, on the Soyuz 2, which was the second mission that the Soviets sent to circle the planet. The first one was a great success. No one knows about the second one because it was not such a great success and it got covered up. So Fontcuberta found all this footage. He found all this footage of the astronaut, I forget the astronaut's name, but meeting the children, giving speeches at the launch, found the doctored photographs where the visage of this person was removed, so removed from history. But then things start to get a little weird, because really? Did he bring his dog? And did his dog go on a spacewalk with him? And of course, if you follow all the photographs through and you know enough about Fontcuberta, it's him. He's the guy in every single photograph. So the entire thing is doctored. And the weird question comes is that this is the fake photograph, right? That's the fake photograph. That's the real photograph. He put himself in there. He made it look older. He wrote stuff on it. But now I'm looking down here. I think somebody did get removed. I don't know who he is and where he went. It's not Joan Fontcuberta, but I have a very different idea about the reality of this photograph because I'm not trusting it anymore. A moment of doubt got clicked, and something allows me to at least engage those images in an entirely different manner. Lo-fi sci-fi. Lo-fi sci-fi is a genre of science fiction movies which have been coming around the last 15 years primarily. And it's a genre which does not ask science fiction to be the fantasy projection of our former cultural mythologies into the future. It's not a superhero science fiction. It's not a Star Wars science fiction. It's a science fiction which is about a reality that's very near to us, just a little bit further than where we are right now. And it asks questions about that movement by accelerating one issue or two issues just a little bit forward to think about then what it means when we reflect on ourselves back in it. So, for instance, something like Antiviral, which is the image in the center, which is made by Brandon Cronenberg, who's David Cronenberg's son, asks, what's the next stage of celebrity worship? If right now you can get your favorite celebrity's autograph, maybe you get your photograph taken with them, maybe you actually meet them, you shake your hand, maybe you're lucky enough that you go to some kind of event or party and they're there and you eat with them and talk to them. Well, the next level is the celebrities sell their viruses. When they get sick, they sell their sicknesses, and you can go by and be injected with their sickness. You can get a little bit closer to your celebrity if you have the same cold sore that she had. You can become a little bit closer to your celebrity if you have that intimate experience of actually sharing biological material. And it's super creepy, and the movie is super creepy, but it's not horror produced. It's not fear produced by horror. It's not laughter produced by comedy, it's not drama produced by the arc of a character, yet all those things are intensified. The easiest way to say it is that you feel uncomfortable about the reality because of how close it possibly could be to a future speculation. And the one I want to call out specifically is Spike Jonze's movie Her. Hope you guys have seen it. It's kind of a beautiful movie. What happens when you fall in love with your operating system? We're all holding our operating systems in our hands. You know, we don't go very far without them. We talk to them now. If they do so, we could very easily fall in love with them. And this plays that out. And it plays it out in a world that we believe to be incredibly real. This is Los Angeles that it takes place in. Like I said, I'm from California. I'm from Los Angeles. I look at that, I see Los Angeles. I see the right mountains, the right light, the right smog. Everything about it feels right. That feels like Los Angeles through and through. But of course, Los Angeles does not have that amount of high-rise. So this is a very different Los Angeles. This is something that takes an existence that is occurring and pushes it, speculates, accelerates on it just a little bit. That, again, could be a place that we've walked through all the time, yet there's something a little bit too abstract about what is above Joaquin Phoenix's head for us to truly treat that as the reality of our everyday. or his apartment. In his apartment, you know, he's into mid-century modernism, he's into minimalism, he's got kind of spaciousness. But there's a thing that once you see it, is enough. It's enough to defamiliarize this scene and let you think that this is not now. And it's his pant line. His pant line's too high, he looks dorky. In the future, your pant lines are gonna be a little bit too high and you're gonna look a little dorky. Now, you can think that this is all to bear on just the whims and shifts and trades of fashion, and yes, of course it is. We used to have bell bottoms, we used to do all these different things. But what it serves in the construction of the aesthetics of that image is it's like the mouse that runs through the corner, the little thing that disturbs the image enough for you to know that it is not now, for you to put a little bit of pressure on the ways in which he inhabits that space, which, by the way, it's so spacious because he plays a virtual reality game in it and he needs that much space to interact with the virtual reality characters. Okay, so a couple projects now from Young and Ayada. This is the most current thing we're doing. It's under construction right now in Los Angeles. It's for an exhibit at SIARC that's opening on Friday about the contemporary detail in digital culture, digital architecture. And so what we decided to do is do new Fry Riglet wall reveals. And we think that's kind of funny because here's this thing that's, you know, running down the baseboard of every single modern gallery, of every single modernist kind of contemporary construction that turns the gypboard wall into an abstract plane that floats free of its ground condition or free of its ceiling condition and doesn't require a baseboard. It gives you a pragmatic thing to mud and tape against and sand so the thing abstracts. All right, let's do new Fry Riglet wall reveals. And that was the premise. And there's something kind of goofy about that. And also we like the idea of SIARC inviting us to do a digital detail and we show up with Simpson strong ties and 2x4s and 2x10s and gypboard. And we just say, yep, we're gonna do more wall reveals and let's see how it pans out. So each of these takes a different condition of the corner or the edge and tries to defamiliarize it. This one's trying to put pressure right on the pinpoint of the corner as a point. This one, which is my favorite, why? Because the walls look wrong. They look like they're janky. They look like they've shifted somehow. So these are our details. These are our reveals. It reminds me a little bit of David Cronenberg's Dead Ringers, if you've ever seen Dead Ringers. So these are the details that we're starting to jack into this construction. So it's under construction right now. These are photographs from yesterday. This is a photograph from today. It goes up, it's installed in by Friday. And we'll see. Hopefully it all comes together. But our effort, at least, to defamiliarize the reality of a standard, everyday aspect of modern construction and to try to push it, pressure it into some other kind of alternate reality. And then this is the last project I'm going to show you. And I tried the video earlier, and the video plays much better if I play it off of my machine. Thank you. So let's get back to the slides. So this was our proposal for the Young Architects program at the Istanbul Modern. It's the same PS1 structure that MoMA has for PS1 in Long Island City. People invited, then five finalists, and this was our proposal. And the thing we're thinking about is how to fill that courtyard. So we're playing on a couple illusions. One is the courtyard as a grove of trees that provide shade. There's two things that constantly are within these competitions, by the way. One is the providing the shade, and the other is a water element. And so for our water element, the whole thing is made out of hose. That's it. We wanted to try to do this with the most standard common construction materials that you could find on any construction site. Hoses, zip ties, rebar, pipes, and rocks. And that's it. Could you do it with those things, and could you begin to build up that world? So the rebar is placed in concrete, placed in pipes. The hoses are draped over the rebar. Some of them pedal up. The zip ties come in to provide the kind of shading pedals on the interior of these. And then rocks are what you sit on. This is how it kind of fills out that garden. All the hoses are draped, then drooped along the ground. And the deal is it becomes an atmospheric world of walking through water. Now actually not touching the water because the water's in the hoses, but as you walk through it, you disturb it, you maneuver it, and actually you are creating a new drawing on the ground because of the excess of the hose that would change over time as the gallery would, as the pavilion would be inhabited. But why it's here and why it's under a title of parafictional realism is the other aspect for all of these projects is how are they reused? What are the ways in which these become recycled? And if you know anything about PVC and plastic, this is not good stuff to recycle. Yet it is the stuff in every construction site. There is something you can do with it, though. You can take the entire thing, turn it upside down, and dump it in the Bosphorus. And the funny thing about that is actually PVC, because it is inert, is one of the recommended materials for artificial reef construction. It just has to be weighted down so that it cannot float off and float into some Pacific gyre and become a big plastic mass. But if it's weighted down, there's a number of habitats that are built for and through PVC. So something that was light and airy and aqueous in a grove above becomes a rock artificial reef that is inhabiting the space below. So that its reuse or its recyclability is that it was 100% flippable to become a habitat in its future for a different kind of life form. And in that, at least we thought, in our mind, we're putting a little bit of pressure on what we understand to be sustainability, this idea of the circle that continually goes and nothing gets bad by the circle continually reusing, is a fiction. Materials leave traces, they have to be dealt with in different manners, and if you can begin to speculate on a kind of reality for their future uses, you're dealing with it, hopefully, in a different manner. The last thing I want to say, and what you've probably been waiting for this entire time, is this. These guys have precursors. Jean-Luc Godard's Alphaville. Jean-Luc Godard's Alphaville makes a very interesting connection, because he makes a connection that science fiction can be dealt with in realism by just disturbing a few key elements, and the ways in which those key elements aesthetically allow you to see just Paris, really. He's just filming, documenting Paris, but you don't see Paris. You see something very different. And that tie, actually, was a tie back to something else, something that's picked up on by Blade Runner. That Blade Runner, as well, as a kind of speculative realism of science fiction, was keen into and tying into another kind of literary genre. And also, I just want to point that one out. Farming the Oceans, the Moon in Antarctica, worldwide computer link-up planned, oh no! That's Harrison Ford and Ridley Scott. The Bradbury Building, the place where the toy maker lives in Blade Runner, which serves as the set for the final scene, is also the set for a whole world of film noir. And the whole world of film noir, based around the literature of Raymond Chandler and Dashiell Hammett, what that was called the hard-boiled crime mystery. Chandler describes the hard-boiled crime mystery in difference to the typical murder mystery. The typical murder mystery, a crime is committed, a murder is committed, Each scene develops that plot little by little by little until you finally figure out who did the crime. Most crime shows you see today are structured exactly this way. Crime is committed in the first 10 minutes, then you wait 60 minutes, figure out who did it. Sometimes it's who you thought it was, sometimes it's not. More or less, pretty good entertainment. Not the hard-boiled murder mystery, because the hard-boiled murder mystery was written and thought through in a very different manner. It was not plot-driven, it was not narrative-driven, it was scene-driven. That you could write a highly descriptive, specific scene, and the narrative ties were haphazard. You'd begin to put the scenes next to each other and see if there was an allusion or an inference or a way of getting from here to there. And you might make that more clear, you might not. If you watch a lot of these movies, there's things that just happen and like, why did that happen? That doesn't make any sense. You're on to another scene. If you've watched a movie by the Coen brothers or Quentin Tarantino, you also know that this is a technique very alive and well. You focus on the scenes, their juxtapositions begin to estrange reality. And that this was much closer to the way in which we actually operated in the world. Highly descriptive scene by highly descriptive scene with some vague terrain connecting them in our minds. It's an observation the situation has had. And it's also an observation that is in realism all the way back to the 19th century. It's in Zola, it's in Flaubert, it's in Courbet, to focus on and speculate through the descriptive details of the real, to estrange them until they become productive in and of themselves, and then to let them roughly rub against each other to produce the possibilities of a new future. And so that's why I call this thing hard-boiled. Thank you. Sure. Any thoughts? Any questions? Yeah.
Before I make a suggestion, in addition to Husker Du, your Coen brothers are from Minneapolis.
Are they?
Your Prince is from Minneapolis.
Yeah, many. I knew.
Hibbing.
Yeah, I know the Dylan piece.
In your work, I thought, why aren't you exploring and maybe you are 3D printing concrete? It seems like a natural.
It's a definite possibility. We actually looked at, we were working with a German engineer for the Bauhaus project, and what we were actually trying to figure out is if we could do it with a kind of 3D printed rammed earth. And that these vessels could begin to have that kind of geological thickness. The thing that kind of came to bear on that was the cost. The reason why we lost the project is we were over the budget and by more than just an acceptable amount. And we were trying to do everything that we could to possibly bring it in. And so structurally tying the entire base in terms of concrete was the way to deal with that. And then the kind of lightness of the wood on top was the way to deal with those shells. But I would love to scale this up. I mean, we're experimenting now all the time with 3D printing at a very small scale, but I think the future is we gotta go one-to-one. It's out there. It's happening. Let's see what we can do with it. Yeah, it's a good suggestion. Yeah. Oh, hey, Mark.
Thanks for a great lecture.
It's thank you.
Really inspiring work, and thank you for critically framing it through the work of artists. It's really well done. I love the idea. There were four of them, I think.
There's four of them.
I'm wondering if that was an example of you capitalizing on a glitch in the material, or how you came about the different kinds of finishes and colorations
sure.
In those projects.
Let's It's easiest. I know this is a little weird to just do this, but I'm trying to think the easiest way to explain this to you. The easiest way is, so we do these kind of funny drawings too. They're drawings that are explorations of the vector space of our software. We're typically moving in between vectors defining the geometries that we build up, or triangulations, either the point associated to a trajectory or the point associated to another point to build up a linear relationship. And so we've done a number of these experiments, which we call drawings, which are actually closer to paintings, which, because we're mainly looking at color and texture and luminosity, but we're doing it through rhino and grasshopper and just trying to build up those kinds of aesthetic effects. Every single one of those vases is this drawing. So it's just that drawing. This drawing was done 2 years before the vases were designed. And then when the vases were designed, there was a very kind of simple form. We actually called it a donkey because we thought it was really dumb looking. And then we called the drawings that we put on them feathers, because we like the idea of pin the tail on the donkey's kind of funny, if you put the feather in the wrong space. If you put the tail in the right place every time, pin the tail on the donkey's not a fun game. It's only fun when you're putting it on the forehead. So if these drawings became an ornamental pattern, and we could put them on in relationship to a cusp in exactly the right place, or put them on in relationship to a surface in exactly the wrong place. So like here'd be us trying to pin the tail correctly on the donkey, and this would be us trying to pin it wrongly. And how you could then, in a single system, build that up as a movement between ornament and decoration. And then the 3D prints, how they're actually done is the drawings are projected, and then we're using a program called Mudbox to build up three-dimensional textures, which is basically like it's like Photoshop in a way, but 3D Photoshop, where there's a pattern there, the pattern there becomes one geometry, that geometry becomes one kind of extrusion, and then you can kind of paint through that pattern and rough it up, glitch it up in a way. And so the glitch in one manner is actually to say that there's something that goes on correctly and doesn't go on correctly, and the mismatched overlap can be productive. And then also that within the textural articulation, you could find a way that it could allude to a different kind of material than the material it was made out of if it had some kind of air in it. I don't know if that's as close as I can get. It's weird to just pull up a website. I'm sorry. Anyways, that was the easiest way I can explain it. Other thoughts?
Yeah. I wonder if you could talk about the use of symmetry in practice. It seems like there's a reemergence of symmetry in architecture, especially in the avant-garde. It's not coming from the classicists. It's coming from people with a lot of sort of geometric exploration. Mark Foster Gage comes to mind, the new opera house that Matt did. All these things are—they're very formal, but they're also driven by symmetry. Or can you talk a little bit about why you think that's important, why you use it?
Sure. We are obviously interested in symmetry, and we're interested in it. There's both a strangeness to it because it's been, in a way, kind of relegated to the backwaters for so long as a thing to explore, but it also begins to immediately produce other associations and other illusions, sometimes desired, sometimes not. But it, let me say it this way. The way we've been trying to formulate it is that there's four ways to think about the symmetrical in relationship to geometry and aesthetics, and it has to do with the difference between global and local. So if you had no local symmetry and no global symmetry, you'd have something like noise or vomit along those lines. If you had all local symmetry, all global symmetry, you'd end up with something like a pure grid. But if you have global symmetry with local asymmetry, you end up with the kinds of drawing paintings we do, you end up with the kind of our Guggenheim entry or the Busan thing, where there's something that's claiming very clearly, again, I'm going back to this, sorry. Very clearly, something that's symmetrical and should be understood as symmetrical, it's the thing that gives you the familiar. But then once you look at it, and this for us is at least the best example, I don't know if I can zoom in on that or not. Once you look at it, it's actually not symmetrical. There's nothing on the left side that's the same as on the right side. So it's a little bit like that thing you walk by, nothing to look at here, symmetrical thing, I think I got it. But nothing on the left is the same as on the right. That actually that tension becomes kind of funny to play against. And then the last thing, which is what I was going to try to say, is local symmetry, global asymmetry, which is what we were trying to do with this and what we're trying to do with the flowers. Now there is one big move of global symmetry, which is this major axis. But if you look around the kind of field, the matrix condition, we're trying to do local symmetries, like flower arrangements. So these two are a pair, these two are a pair, those two are a pair, these two are a pair. But in the overall field of them, you don't read them as an automatically globally symmetrical object. It's much more like when what happens when dogs jump on top of each other and pile. They may be symmetrical, but they pile in asymmetrical ways. It's one of the flower vase things. Or the twinning of the corbeille, or flower arrangement. Flower arrangement is always using local symmetries, but usually are globally asymmetrical. So we're interested in it. It's something that you can play against. It's something that you can play with. It's something that sometimes when it occurs becomes the strangest thing there, and then sometimes provides the kind of backdrop to move against.
Yes? I think you arrived to your definition of form mostly through the idea of abstraction or the idea of a digital transformations. But at the same time, I think, or at least I see a lot of analogies with the research into biomorphic shapes, forms, system structures, which were carried out since, I would say, the 40s and 50s. You know, there are many architects that looked at that kind of world, the world of biomorphic elements. Mm-hmm. Are you also looking at that, or you arrive to this, let's say, results through other ways?
I'd say two things. One, we're trying to find a way to think about abstraction that is outside of purely geometry and transformation. We're trying to think about what abstraction can do aesthetically to conditions of estrangement. So that is something we're trying in doing it more and more. But without a doubt, there is biomorphic research into this project. Those things begin to become like legs. Those things begin to become like bodies. Those things begin to become like bellies. Those things begin to become characters that have those associations. And I don't know if this means that we're in a transitional stage or not. If our, again, I'm answering the question like this. Our earlier work was much more quite clearly biomorphically generated and working on those kinds of illusions and metaphors. And it's not that we discount them now in any way. We're fascinated by them, and I'm sure we're fascinated by several of the same architects that have kind of come through experiments in history to build these kinds of structures and experiment with these kinds of forms. But I do think we're trying to challenge that at least a little bit in our own aesthetics and in our own work to see, I don't know, to see where else it can go. And I feel we are in a period of transition, but I feel like we've been in a period of transition since we started, and I hope we always feel like we're in a period of transition. I'm usually happiest when I don't know exactly what the next thing is going to be. So the thing I'm the most excited about right now are those silly wall reveal details at SciArc, because that is just, it's almost bordering on dumb, and I don't know about you, but there's just, it's like, yeah, let's do that. Let's make a wall look like it was built wrong, just by doing a detail that's fabricated digitally. And anyways, if we could pull that off, I'm kind of interested there too. other?
Well, thank you, Michael.
All right, guys. Yeah. Thank you. We'll see you the rest of the week.